Well, thank you all for joining us on this outstanding event on the issues surrounding the public health issues raised by Dobbs. I'm Christopher Yu, a professor here at the law school, where I'm also the founding director of the Center for Technology, Innovation, and Competition. We are delighted to be co-hosting with the Department of Medical Ethics and Health Policy this event, which is part of a growing collaboration between our two organizations, which we couldn't be happier for. Allison Hoffman, Deputy Dean and also Professor here at the Law School, was instrumental in pulling this together, as was Emily Largent, Hollis Fernandez Lynch, and other fantastic people who are here joining us today. We're delighted to have you all in this hybrid event. There's a number of you, for those of you who are online, there's a lot of us who are joining here in the room in person, and for those of us who are in person, you can see there's a great deal, there's a large audience online. I do have a number of logistical announcements to deal with. First, for those who are participating online, we request that you submit your questions through the Q&A function, which will be visible to the panelists, and they will moderate it from here. Second is, for those of you who are getting continuing legal education credit, there will be three words subjected to the poll function. Those of you who are online will see them, and you can dismiss that that word as soon as you see it. For those of you who are getting CLE here in the room, they will be visible on the screen here. Make sure you write them down, and if there's any issues surrounding it, here is the first word showing up right now. And if that's a problem, please let us know afterwards, and we would be happy to make sure that you have any words that you miss. That's it. And the last issue is that we are recording this event, and will be put out on our YouTube channel after event, just so you know, all the speakers have already consented, but for those of you who are attending in person in the room, we thought that important that you know that anything you say in the room in the Q&A will be recorded and shared with the public.
But you're not on video.
You will not be on video. And we will have the room microphones turned off during the main presentation portion of the section. We will turn them on during the question and answer session, so those who are online will submit their questions to the Q&A function. Those here in the room can simply raise your hand. Professor Hoffman will recognize you, and then we will pass you into the queue and allow you to be integrated by our outstanding moderator, who will be Dorothy Roberts. Before I hand it off to our colleague Dorothy, anything else you'd like to? Without further ado, Professor Dorothy Roberts, who will be chairing this fantastic panel today. Take it away, Dorothy.
Thanks so much, Christopher. I'm really, really excited to be able to moderate this really extraordinary panel on the wide reach of the Dobbs decision. And I believe everybody has received the panelists' bios. I'm going to read shortened versions of them for the sake of time. And then we'll move on to a discussion. And as Professor Yu said, there'll be opportunity for Q&A afterward. So Greer Donley is a John E. Murray faculty scholar and associate professor of law at the University of Pittsburgh Law School. She's an expert on abortion and the law. She also has published widely and has been quoted extensively in the media, especially on topics related to medication abortion, interjurisdictional abortion conflicts, and the impact of abortion bans on other aspects of reproductive health care, particularly pregnancy loss. Her popular writing often appears in the New York Times, The Atlantic, and other major media outlets like that, and her scholarly works have been published or are forthcoming in Columbia Law Review and other prestigious law journals. She's perhaps best known for her co-authored paper, The New Abortion Battleground, which has been cited widely, including by the Supreme Court's dissent in Dobbs. Next, we have Professor Wendy Parmet, who was the George J. and Kathleen Waters Matthews Distinguished Professor of Law and Professor of Public Policy and Urban Affairs at Northeastern University, where she's the faculty director of the Center on Health Policy and Law. Professor Parmet is the author of over 100 law review and peer-reviewed articles. Her books include Constitutional Contagion, COVID, the Courts and Public Health, which will be published by Cambridge University Press this year, the Health of Newcomers, Immigration, Health Policy, and the Case for Global Solidarity. and also populations, public health, and the law. Next, we have Patty Zettler, who is an associate professor at the Ohio State University Moritz College of Law and a faculty member of the Ohio State's Drug Enforcement and Policy Center and its Comprehensive Cancer Center. Her research and teaching focus on FDA law and policy, torts, legislation, and regulation. Her scholarship has appeared in leading legal and health sciences journals such as the New England Journal of Medicine, JAMA, and Science, and has covered various topics, including expanded access, biohacking, stem cell interventions, opioids, cannabis products, tobacco and nicotine products, and COVID-19 countermeasures. She's also co-author of the fifth edition of Food and Drug Law, Cases and Materials. And before entering academics, Professor Zettler served as an attorney in the office of the chief counsel at the FDA. So you could see that we really have quite a lineup of very, very expert speakers on these topics. So I will start with you, Greer. I hope it's okay if I use first names. Please call me Dorothy. And in looking at the many, many ways that Dobbs will shape legal doctrine in the coming years, well beyond the issue of the legal right to abortion, which has been the focus, but our point is to look beyond that. So I'll start with you, Greer. What are some changes that you anticipate in the realm of substantive due process in the short and long term, apart even from the specific focus on the constitutional right to abortion? And what will the impact of those changes be?
Great. Well, first, thank you so much to be here. It's such a delight and an honor to be with this great group. So, you know, for those of you who are going back to 1L con law, you'll remember that so much of substantive due process, so much of the work of substantive due process happens at that initial question about what is a fundamental right. And historically, courts have looked at a few different tests to try to determine what a fundamental right was. But in Dobbs, the court seemed to really narrow down and focus on this history and tradition test, focusing particularly on what was, you know, a right at around the time of the 14th Amendment's ratification in particular, but especially, you know, just looking back in time at the history of our country. And so, you know, obviously when the court did that, looked backwards in that way, although historians are quick to take, take some criticism of the court's analysis, the court, you know, purports to do a historical analysis and suggests that at the time of the founding, especially around the time of the 14th Amendment's ratification, the middle of the 1800s, the court says that laws were changing and that it was actually quite common for there to be laws that criminalized abortion and said that there was no right that was grounded in kind of this history and tradition test. So, you know, I think when we look forward at what this new kind of understanding of substantive due process is going to mean, obviously, you know, many people have talked about, well, what happens when we really are only looking at the rights that were held historically, particularly around the time of the 14th Amendment, right? Who had rights then? It wasn't women, it wasn't people of color, it wasn't LGBT folks, right? And so when you really start to think about the, you know, future cases coming before the court that are now using this new test, this not new test, but this test that the court is saying is the test for deciding substantive due process, you start to get very concerned, right? Because I can guarantee you that we did not have, there was no right to contraception that existed in the middle of the 1800s. There was no right to marry who you love that existed in the middle of the 1800s, right? And so, you know, people are quick to point out that even though Justice Alito took great pains in his opinion to say abortion is different. This is not going to cause the slippery slope that liberals are inevitably going to say it's going to cause, because abortion is ending an unborn life, in his words. You know, many people are saying, well, if you look at, if you just look at the test and try to apply that test and to, you know, potential future cases involving, you know, the right to Plan B or gay marriage. You might be very concerned about how that test could possibly end up in a world where those rights are affirmed under substantive due process. And so, you know, obviously Justice Thomas and his concurrence, you know, lays that argument out and specifically says, let's reanalyze some of these new rights. And so, you know, I think that what does this mean for the future? I think we have to kind of wait and see what state legislatures do. Many people are saying, right, this is hyperbolic. At this day and age, we aren't going to have a state legislature that's willing to ban contraception. And I would just remind everyone that Hobby Lobby, the decision about contraception and the Affordable Care Act, was not very long ago. And that even though it might be unlikely that a state bans all birth control, there are certain types of birth control that the anti-abortion movement is on record saying are actually abortifacients, right? Those types of birth control are Plan B and IUDs. And I can certainly imagine a world in which state legislatures do try to ban those types of birth control on the grounds that they are abortion. And I don't, you know, I think that using the same kind of test that the court has, you know, written out in Dobbs, it's going to be hard to imagine that type of legislative action would be struck down. And so, you know, I think we're going to have to kind of wait and see how audacious state legislatures are, but certainly, you know, this case provides the groundwork to unravel many rights that are important for public health and very important for the justice issues so many of us care about.
Yeah, thank you. I think that is a very frightening prospect of the possible implications of going back to a time when only wealthy white men were entitled to influence political decisions, at least legally, not to say that other people didn't. But the other thing that really infuriates me about that decision is not only that narrow interpretation of the 14th Amendment, but completely ignoring the fact that the 14th Amendment was a Reconstruction Amendment that was passed to abolish slavery and give Black people and everyone equal rights. So it leaves that part of the 14th Amendment out as well. It leaves out the history, the real history of the 14th Amendment, which is doubly frightening and infuriating. But thank you so much for that. So Patty, you're an expert on FDA regulation. What are the implications of Dobbs for FDA regulation and the future of federal state preemption questions? I haven't heard much discussion about that at all. And what do you see a connection there?
Yeah, thank you for that question. And I want to echo Greer's thanks to the Penn faculty and staff for putting together this terrific event and for all of you for joining us. And of course, to Dorothy, Greer, and Wendy, it's really, I'm really grateful to have the opportunity to join all of you in this discussion. So the question about what Dobbs means for FDA regulation and questions about the intersection of FDA and state regulation, of course, I'm biased to think is a really interesting and important one, but I think it is really a really interesting and important one. I think the short answer is we don't know yet, but I think there are a lot of things to keep on our radar. So as you mentioned, as Dorothy mentioned in Greer's introduction, she's an expert on medication abortion, among other things. And she and other leading scholars in the area, even before Dobbs, were interested in the possibility that FDA oversight of mifepristone, which is a prescription drug approved for abortion through 10 weeks of pregnancy, or roughly 10 weeks of pregnancy, the possibility that FDA oversight there and preemption challenges grounded in the fact that FDA so tightly regulates that drug could be successful. And interest in those kinds of preemption challenges, I think, has only increased since Dobbs. So the day that Dobbs issued, the Attorney General issued a statement saying, among other things, quote, FDA has approved the use of the medication mifepristone. States may not ban mifepristone based on disagreement with FDA's expert judgment about its safety and efficacy, end quote. So there are, for those of us that sort of need a reminder about what preemption is, preemption comes from the Supremacy Clause of the US Constitution, which says that federal law shall be the supreme law of the land. So this is a wholly separate constitutional question in substantive due process. And basically what that means is that where federal law and state law conflict, federal law wins. Federal law preempts or displaces state law. And there are various ways that courts can conclude that Congress intended federal law to preempt state law. You know, I think Greer and her collaborators, David Cohen and Rachel Ray Boucher, some colleagues and I are on a similar page in that we think there are actually pretty good arguments here that FDA's oversight of mifepristone preempts many state restrictions or bans on the drugs. And I think that could even be true if we're talking about states implementing complete or near complete bans on all abortion care, not just the drug specifically. And I'm happy to talk more about the details of those arguments in the Q&A, but in terms of thinking about implications for other areas, okay, so that could be a real win for public health in the abortion context. But abortion is not the only area where states are interested in regulating prescription drugs or other drugs within FDA's jurisdiction. Greer mentioned some other examples like birth control, hormonal birth control, or IUDs. Here in Ohio, there have been bills proposed to ban insurance coverage for IUDs. And so there are all these other areas where whatever happens in the abortion context might have implications for how far states can go to regulate products or how much leeway states have to regulate products that FDA is already tightly regulating. Outside of reproductive health altogether, states impose a lot of restrictions on opioid painkillers, for example. So there might be implications in that space. As we've all seen, states have been quite interested in shaping the use of COVID vaccines or sort of in what's happening with COVID vaccines over the past few years. That might be another area where we see this intersection. So I think looking at, well, what happens if someone does in fact challenge state restrictions on abortion care on FDA preemption grounds, what happens with that case? What does the court actually say about it? And keeping an eye on what that means for other areas where states also regulate prescription drugs, I think will be an important question to watch. And there are also probably going to be questions outside the prescription drug context as well. So we might think about or outside of the marketing of approved prescription drugs, we might think about, well, what happens? How do we conduct clinical trials with pregnant people if there are these risks of, if states are criminalizing abortion or there are other sort of risks, data privacy risks that didn't previously exist? What might be the implications for digital health products? So I think there are all kinds of ways that there will be these ripple effects of Dobbs, even though the Dobbs decision itself does not directly affect FDA's authority. I'll stop there. So thank you.
Thanks for that, Wendy. And, you know, I really appreciated, Patty, how you and Greer are working on intersecting issues and how your comments came together in that way. It's very encouraging also to have two brilliant people working on these issues, among others. Wendy, what about the implications of Dobbs for the future of public health more broadly? Because we're all talking about public health, but that field in particular, in terms of which policymaking authorities will be left to the states, which will be held by the federal government. One urgent area where this comes up is the way that governments are addressing COVID. Do you think that Dobbs might have an effect on how we address COVID and face the next pandemic, for example?
So thank you so much, for that question. And I also want to join my fellow panelists in thanking you for inviting me to this really important discussion and being on this amazing panel with these brilliant thinkers and scholars. I want to answer that question in two different ways. One I would call direct, the other, I think I'll start out by exploring a paradox and then maybe rejecting the paradox if I can. So directly, I think, you know, it goes, I think, without saying that Dobbs is likely to have a very significant adverse impact on public health, right? And this is operating at several levels through several different pathways. Obviously, pregnant persons with high-risk pregnancies are being forced to face higher risks. We're hearing more of these stories. In the next year or two, we'll start to really get data, but I think everybody in the field is anticipating the data will be deeply troubling. Individuals who need medications and sometimes procedures for non-reproductive health are facing barriers, like people who have experienced lupus, cancer treatments are being affected, right? And then people who are denied access to abortion face higher pregnancy risks. Their children face higher rates of low birth rate. And then the economic, and we don't talk about this enough, right? But the economic ripples, the stresses that people and families face when they have to bear and raise children that are unwanted, unplanned pregnancies, when they don't have the, you know, financial wherewithal, all of this has health impacts down the stream, right? Reproductive health care, access to it, is a significant determinant of health. But I take your question at least as an invitation to talk a little bit about a different way that Dobbs may affect public health and through public health law. And here, I think at least we need to think about a potential paradox. For most of the past 2+ years, many of us in public health law have lamented the erosion of what we can call public health powers. In the Supreme Court, since Justice Ginsburg joined the bench, has refused to grant state public health officials pretty much any deference, right? Especially, but not only, in free exercise clause claims. The opinions in these cases seem to reflect a very strongly individualistic perspectives. Individuals have the right to ignore public health orders if they say their religion commands it, including to, you know, have people in their home. If they say they want to do it for Bible study, well, then they get to do it. COVID, you know, forget about that. Forget about what the science says. These cases assert a very heightened form of judicial review in which the justices have been content to ignore scientific facts. They seem absolutely unconcerned about what the science has to say, and they are unconcerned about what the lower courts have to say. There is no judicial humility. There's no concern for what we might call the passive virtues. There's no respect for the democratic process. There's no concern for the health implications. Indeed, the courts seem content, the Supreme Court at least has seemed content at times to accept the fact that their decisions will lead to many more deaths. So be it. Then comes along Dobbs. And if one was in the business of looking for silver linings, I think you might say, well, the court in Dobbs was trying to rebalance the relationship between the courts and the state's police power, which, again, I think got out of balance during the pandemic. The court is trying to rebalance the relationship between a Supreme Court that limits what the states can do in the name of health and the political and the states or the political branches. The Dobbs court, after all, expresses the view that critical decisions should be left generally to the political branches. And it expresses perhaps a refreshing recognition of the limits of its own competence. Now, this may be catastrophic, and I think it is for reproductive health care, but if one was looking for silver linings, right, one will say, well, gee, you know, that might be not so bad when it comes to the vaccine cases, right? I mean, the courts recognizing that decisions should be left to the political branches, that's refreshing. Maybe it means, you know, that the court might be more, next pandemic, willing to accept if states say certain kinds of businesses need to close down. Maybe they accept the fact that they are not the scientific experts. After all, that's what they say in Dobbs. And it's possible in one case that was decided last summer, challenging New York State's school vaccine laws, the plaintiffs relied on Casey, Planned Parenthood versus Casey, to say that the state cannot mandate vaccines. And the court rejected it in part, noting, albeit in a footnote, well, Dobbs says Casey's no longer there. You can't make the claim that you have a substantive due process right not to be vaccinated. Okay. So there's that silver lining, but it is, I think, a mirage. And that's because Dobbs, in the end, is far less about the police power and respect for the state's historical capacity to protect public health, and less about the court's long tradition of judicial deference for health and science, than it is about assuring a particular political and theological perspective on health law. And in that sense, the Dobbs cases, with their stark privileging of free exercise claims, and Dobbs are soulmates. Like the COVID cases, Dobbs displays a truly surprising, historically shocking indifference to science or the impact of judicial decisions on the health of the public. Mm-hmm. And as in the COVID vaccine cases, for example, the case striking OSHA's vaccine mandate, the Dobbs court truly does not seem to care if it leads to deaths. One other point. If Dobbs was truly a police power case, as say Jacobson versus Massachusetts, the old 1905 Supreme Court precedent that the court cast aside in 2020, which upheld a vaccine mandate, the court, it might have federalism implications. You could imagine a court, a Supreme Court, saying that really this is about returning public health to the states in the tradition of Jacobson and the tradition of Gibbons versus Obden, and, you know, time and time again. And there's language of that potential in some of the recent Supreme Court's cases, including West Virginia versus EPA and the OSHA case. We can even find it in the 2012 NFB versus Sebelius, the Obamacare case. But I don't think we should be misled into thinking that these are true police power cases, or that the court is actually motivated about ensuring that health is protected at the local level. When the federal government attempts to protect health, and I think this may apply to some of these preemption issues too, alas, the court emphasizes states' rights. And when the states try to protect health, as they tried to do during COVID, the court is happy to reject those states' efforts on the basis of free exercise rights and rights about in other Second Amendment rights, as in the gun case. So in all these instances, health loses. That's the through line. Health loses, science loses. And so as we think about the health crises to come, climate change, gun violence, reproductive health, the next pandemic, what we have is a court, I fear, that is leaving us as a nation increasingly incapable of responding to those crises. And it's kind of like whack-a-mole. You try to solve it at the state level, you're knocked down. You try to stop it at the federal level, you're knocked down. In that sense, Dobbs is just one more nail in the public health coffin. Sorry to be so pessimistic.
Thank you for that astute analysis, even though it's very distressing that there is this through line. What makes these cases reconcilable is that theme of health loses. And of course, people in power than the status quo win at the expense of human lives. That is very distressing, but thank you for telling us straight up what is at risk here and what the stakes are. I think that's important. So we've looked at several areas where Dobbs' reach extends beyond the question of whether there's a legal right to abortion protected by the US Constitution to these other areas related to public health and FDA regulation and interpretation of substantive due process. I'm wondering if there are yet other areas that Dobbs affects that maybe we haven't discussed so far. I want to throw out a couple and see if you have others, a couple related to areas I teach in criminal law and family law, especially child welfare law, and the criminalization of pregnancy, not only of abortion, but also of behavior that's seen to be risky to a fetus, pregnancy loss, as well as termination of pregnancy, but also, and this is something that I think Greer and Patty both brought up and is implied by Wendy's comments as well, criminalization of healthcare providers who are trying to protect people's health, have been being fearful that treating someone, trying to improve someone's health, trying to protect someone's life could be considered a crime. Encouraging people to become agents for the state and punishing people who aid people seeking healthcare, you know, this expansion of criminalization. And then in another area I work in, child welfare law, the proposal, even by members of the US Supreme Court, that adoption is a solution for forced births. The implications for the foster system and adoption when they're seen as the remedies for forcing people to give birth. So those are just two that come to mind related to my areas that I'm working in. I'm sure there are others as well, or maybe you want to say more about those, but feel free, whoever would like to speak first, just go ahead. Thanks, Greer.
Yeah, so first of all, thanks for the question. And it should be noted that Dorothy is a truly like remarkable scholar in all of these areas. So, you know, we're just learning from her here. But I do want to just say that something that hasn't been explicitly said right now yet, which is that all of the negative impacts of Dobbs in every aspect, right, from maternal health care to criminalization, are going to be felt disproportionately by marginalized communities. And so, you know, that's for a lot of reasons, right? I mean, it's predominantly women of color, but it's also poor folks, it's minors, it's disabled folks, it's LGBT folks. You know, when you look at who's more likely to be forced to continue a pregnancy, it's mostly going to be poor women and disproportionately women of color, because those are the folks that are going to be less likely to afford to travel elsewhere to get an abortion. Those people are also much more likely to have high-risk pregnancies, right? The maternal mortality rate for Black women is 3 times what it is for white women. So when we think about the consequences of this, it is really important we all understand that this is really going to be felt very painfully in certain communities, mm-hmm. that those are not going to be spread out amongst everybody. Mm-hmm. Then when you think about, you know, even the folks who are able to access abortion, either through, you know, self-managed abortion, a topic we haven't yet talked about, but where people buy medication abortion online, usually from online pharmacies, and take it even in a state that bans abortion, which is becoming increasingly common, or folks who leave and come back, you know, the people who are going to be criminalized are most likely going to be the people who are already criminalized in our current justice system, right? Mm-hmm. And so that's a real serious problem, and something that we should all deeply, deeply care about. And then, of course, when we talk about, I'm not a family law expert at all, but, you know, when we talk about the consequences for family law, you know, it's really important that everyone recognize the reproductive justice movement, you know, cares not only about the right to not have children, but also the right to have children and the right to parent those children with dignity. And the people who are going to be forced to give birth are also way more likely to have their children taken from them in a family law system that is unjust. And so, you know, I think we really have to be thinking holistically in this moment and about who are going to be bearing the pains of this horrible decision. So then I guess the other thing I'll just mention that we also haven't talked quite yet about is just, you know, the interstate conflicts and the federal and state conflicts that are coming down the pike, right? So, you know, Justice Scalia, which famously said long ago that if, you know, we overturn Roe, we'll get the federal courts out of the abortion umpiring business, and, you know, it'll be way easier. But we're already seeing that that is a complete and total fallacy, right? You know, Patty, who is, by the way, right, the true FDA law scholar who is writing in this space, and if you care about medication abortion preemption, please read her fantastic papers on it. But she talked about, right, one of the very important federal state conflicts coming down the pike, but we're going to see, you know, EMTALA. You've probably read in the news that that is actually potentially teeing up to be the first Supreme Court, the first circuit split about federal state powers. We're going to see states battling each other. The courts are going to be mired in this, in these conflicts for a long time. And so, you know, unfortunately, you know, this, the whole overturning Roe is going to really challenge notions of federalism in this country as well. And I'll just, you know, say that that is something I've worked on with David Cohen and Rachel Ray Boucher, who have been fantastic partners in my research. But yeah, that's it.
Thanks. And thanks for highlighting who is disproportionately going to be burdened by this and the importance of a reproductive justice approach then for addressing all of these harms that are inflicted by the Dobbs decision. Wendy, do you want to?
Yeah, thank you. And obviously, I want to underscore everything that Greer just said. Totally agree. A couple of quick points. One, picking up on the federalism and EMTALA and your article, Greer, on this is amazing. I think of the term that Caroline Corbin said years ago called abortion distortions. And at that point, she was particularly focusing on First Amendment and how abortion litigation has the capacity to distort doctrine, right? The courts are so, in a sense, motivated and states are so motivated. I think as we see this federalism litigation coming down the pike, and I'm particularly worried about EMTALA, we should not assume that everything we knew about federalism, preemption, and EMTALA will survive the frankly results-oriented Supreme Court on abortion. And so I think there's a real risk. You know, people are talking about substantive due process, and I'll get to that in a sec, but there's a real risk that at the end of the day, you know, I hope this is wrong, but there's a risk that EMTALA itself, the Emergency Medical Treatment and Active Labor Act, which requires hospitals to provide care in an emergency room, regardless of payment status, regardless of immigration status, regardless of so many other statuses, we will end up with a court decision that says, well, actually the states can override EMTALA. If that happens, you could imagine states passing laws that say that undocumented individuals, hospitals don't have to treat them. And I'm terrified of this, but I can imagine this abortion litigation getting us there. I'm not predicting it will happen. I'm saying that there is that risk. If I want to go down the parade of horribles further, the Supreme Court in Dobbs dismisses the equal protection claim. that many people who have been critical of Roe and Casey said, well, equal protection was really the way to go. Mm-hmm. And they revived the long discredited Geduldig versus IAO, which said you basically, well, discrimination against pregnant persons, you know, is not discrimination on the basis of gender. Are they really gonna run with that? That, you know, and what else about equal protection doctrine? Where does that take us? Again, I don't want to spend too much time on going down the parade of horribles, but it does make you wonder how far the Supreme Court will go in sort of, in again, sort of taking away gender protections on the basis of gender under equal protection, even in other areas. Reviving Geduldig is problematic. It's never been overruled, but it's been kind of, you know, cast in the shadows there by the Pregnancy Discrimination Act and subsequent Supreme Court cases. The last thing I'll say is one area that I've seen less discussion about, and the colleagues on the panel may know more about this, is actually constitutional rights to privacy around medical care. So in an old decision called Whalen versus Roe, the Supreme Court talks about a post-Roe decision, another Roe in the title, the court finds out that there's no fundamental right to privacy in your medical records or keeping the state from finding your medical information, but that there is a liberty interest that's worthy of some protection. And this is a very much a post-Roe decision. Many of the lower federal courts have used this and developed a balancing test, sometimes called the Westinghouse test, but allowing people in certain situations, not a fundamental right, but to bring cases where states have violated their medical confidentiality. It's a limited right, it's a balancing test, it's not a fundamental right, but it can be an important right. And you think about populations that are, you know, people with highly stigmatized conditions, HIV, mental health, you know, can you imagine a state website listing everybody who, you know, went to a physician for trans care, for example, if I'm going down the parade of horribles? I think it's questionable whether Whalen, which is the, sort of the foundation for Westinghouse, is going to be able to survive because it's so built on Roe. So that's another area where I think we need to keep our eyes open and maybe be a little concerned about.
Yeah, thanks. Okay, Patty, are you going to?
Well, I'm just going to
down the parade of horribles.
Yeah, I'm just going to echo 2 points. I know it's boring when panelists agree with one another, but I agree with everything Greer and Wendy said. And I also want to mention, I know from my colleague who's been at the American Public Health Association meeting this week, that yesterday Wendy was honored with the Lifetime Achievement in Public Health Law Award at that conference. So I think we can all understand why hearing Wendy's analyses of these issues. But just two sort of thoughts from sort of the drug policy and FDA perspective. So as Dorothy mentioned in my introduction, I'm a faculty member of the Drug Enforcement and Policy Center here at Ohio State, and that center has focused primarily on cannabis, but on drug decriminalization quite a bit and kind of what happens next. And in those sorts of drug policy circles, right, we're pretty used to thinking about the war on drugs disproportionately impacting marginalized communities, at least in recent years, right? And everything Greer said about medication abortion, there's no reason to think that it would be any different there, right? It's just sort of an extension in some ways of, you know, we know what happens when drug use is criminalized and who is impacted most by that. Just to echo Wendy's point about, you know, abortion distortion, and we don't know what's going to happen with federalism, just to sort of say it transparently, I think, and I think Greer agrees with me, but she should feel free to disagree. I think there are really strong, really compelling legal arguments that mifepristone, among all prescription drugs, has been far more heavily scrutinized than FDA than most prescription drugs. And there are quite compelling logical legal preemption arguments with respect to mifepristone for a variety of reasons. The reality is, though, preemption is not automatic. Someone has to bring a lawsuit and challenge a state restriction on preemption grounds. And then, as Wendy pointed out, courts who are full of judges who are people have to decide that the state law is in fact preempted. So whatever we think about the legal merits of the arguments, I do think there's real practical concern about whether, in fact, this Supreme Court or some judges on lower courts would agree even with the most compelling arguments.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we probably could go on with more terrifying implications of Dobbs. I think this has just been such a disturbing but informative discussion about the wide range of the wide reach of the Dobbs decision in so many important, you know, life and death, literally, aspects of our politics and our lives. I think we should spend, before we turn to Q&A, some time discussing what we need to do. Has the Dobbs decision and these implications we've been discussing made you think about the legal frameworks we've historically relied on for protecting our freedoms and our health in different ways? What tools should people, especially the students who are in the audience, think about using in order to change this trajectory that we've been talking about?
I can start there too. So I'll just say that, you know, I entered academia 5 years ago. And when I did, I really wanted to write in the repro space, but I was very nervous. You know, I felt like there was these incredible people who had been doing this forever. And I felt very nervous to enter it and to feel like I had anything I could add. You know, and I think that actually we're kind of in a moment where we are really desperate for newcomers and for people with ideas that are different, right? So, you know, I've had the really good fortune recently to work a lot with legislators, to work a lot with advocates, to work a lot with abortion providers in the strategy of the next, you know, the next phase of this fight and this movement. And, you know, the truth is that for the past 50 years, Roe has really set, and Casey really set the whole groundwork for what people were doing, right? Everyone was doing constitutional law. All the repro people were litigating constitutional law. They were all constitutional law scholars. And that has been blown away, right? So we now are in a world where we need people to join the repro movement who are criminal law people, who are FDA law people, who are postal law people. Like, I can't tell you the number of times where my co-authors and I have been like, we need a postal law expert, right? You know, imagine any type of law. We need people in the repro space now because we need cyber law people. We need privacy people. Everything is different. You know, my co-authors Rachel David and I wrote a shorter piece in Stanford Law Review Online about how, you know, this is the time to be making creative arguments that the anti-abortion movement was really successful over the last 50 years at just throwing everything at the wall and seeing what it could stick. They were creative. They were constantly forcing the abortion rights movement to be on the defensive. You know, this is the kind of the moment in my mind that we need that same kind of energy. We need to be, you know, EMTALA, right? FDA preemption, you know, anything you can think of as a way of chipping away or challenging these state abortion laws is important and it's new. You know, no one thought that SB 8, right? That's the law in Texas that essentially ended abortion after 6 weeks, 9 months before the Supreme Court overturned Roe and Dobbs. No one thought it was constitutional. No one thought it was possible that it was going to be upheld, right? And it had this enormous impact. So I think that in this moment, you know, as to the extent that I'm speaking to students, you know, I think we need new energy, we need new ideas, we need creativity, and we need people that are coming at this from a different way of thinking in this moment.
Thanks. That's, oops, sorry. I did the wrong thing. I think that's so encouraging. And I love the way you approach this as an exciting opportunity for students and scholars in a variety of areas of the law and other disciplines as well to get involved. Let's see. I think, Wendy, do you want to?
Yeah, very quickly, building on Greer, I agree we need creativity, we need new energy, but we also actually need a long-term strategy. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we need to throw a lot of things out, but I think we need to recognize that what we're seeing at this moment with Dobbs, but it's not just Dobbs, as I said, it's the COVID cases, it's killing the EPA, it's all of the above, mm-hmm. is the culmination of a very, very well thought out 50-year judicial legal strategy that started out with, you know, fringe ideas that became mainstream in much of academia, that got infiltrated the federal bench, right? It's a different way of seeing the world than the world was seen in 1973. The folks on the other side need a similar kind of coordinated strategy. It might have a lot of little parts to it, but, you know, it's hard because the money's on the other side. That's the first thing. And the second thing I just want to say is that a part of that strategy, it might be, and now I'm getting back to my earlier thing, is it may be that it has to be less court-centric. And it may be about remembering that for most of its history, with a few decades of exception, the Supreme Court has primarily been a force to conserve and continue oppression in this country, right? I mean, the Supreme Court has not been a liberatory force. It has not been a force for progressive change for much of its history. A court unleashed like this court is dangerous. And this court, even in Dobbs, I mean, look what it did, even if you, right? I mean, it reached out to take issues not before it. It decided to go even John Roberts said, oh, you're going too fast. We need to, I think, go back and not be so quick to argue that courts should be big and bold, because big and bold courts more often than not end up hurting the people in this country who have experienced the most oppression, who have been marginalized the most. So I think we need to move away from the courts to somewhat and sort of keep them in their place.
Thanks for reminding us we need a long-term strategy as we also include various fields in that strategy. Patty, do you want to add anything?
I will just add briefly that I think, at least reflecting on things that I sometimes hear from my students in not just the, you know, not just the health space, but sort of all across the board, is if professors say things like, well, you have to think practically about what's the court actually going to do or what's the agency actually going to do, not just sort of what the best legal arguments are, that feels disheartening. But I think to return to Greer's comments, this is a moment where actually we need all of the skills that, and we as lawyers are very well prepared for sort of critical and creative thinking. And so it is a time to really use your skills for the things you want to see in the world.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, great. Thank you for that. I would just add that part of the reason the right has been so successful in its 50-year strategy is that it also included political organizing. And we need to get better at organizing with people outside of academia and outside the legal field in order to win this battle. So thank you so much for such generative, provocative, informative, disturbing, but yet I think also hopeful discussion about the wide reach of the Dobbs decision. And now I will turn it over for Q&A. I know that Allison Hoffman is in the room with the live hands up. And I was just putting in the chat, I have, I believe, four questions. So I don't know, Allison, do you want to kind of go back and forth with in-person online questions?
That's great. Why don't you take the first one from the online and then I'll-
Okay. All right, is it okay to say the names of the people who are asking questions? Should I or not? What is the protocol, you know? Or should I just ask anonymous questions?
Yeah, you just ask anonymous questions.
Okay, so the first question is, okay, I'm gonna be looking up because I have a bigger screen above. Okay, that's why I'm not getting these questions from heaven. Okay, this is an actual person who asked, there's much talk that the public health infrastructure was not up to the job of dealing with COVID and we need to change it, invest more in it. From what today's speakers are saying, we could invest in a better public health infrastructure, whatever that might require, and still deal poorly with public health problems because that infrastructure would not be allowed to do what's needed to be done. Is there any way that the public health infrastructure can be equipped to deal better with public health in spite of these restrictions? And it sounds like maybe, Wendy, you're the but others feel free to jump in.
You know, I've been around APHA annual meeting the last few days too, and there is definitely a sense of a sober mood. But there's also optimism. I mean, my message has been rely less on law, you know, talking about infrastructure, rely less sometimes on power. I mean, it's easy to think that most of what public health does is about power and rules, but, you know, vaccine mandates, for example, which I do think can be essential in certain circumstances, but a lot of the, you know, the positive side of the COVID vaccine story, for example, and there are negative sides too, and we could talk about that, but the positive side is actually the way things sprung up in early 2021 and millions of people got vaccinated and the messaging got out. Now, there was a lot of bad messaging and there was access and equity issues, but there's also, it reminds us that there's a lot of on the ground work that doesn't require legal rules that can't end up on SCOTUS's docket. Like what you want to do right now when you're in public health is avoid SCOTUS. But there's a lot of, but giving out vaccines, giving out better messages, helping communities and working with community partners to get the messages out about how people can be healthy. There's a lot that can be done. And particularly in states that also want to invest and care about equity. So there's a lot that can be done. There's just a lot of, you know, there are places where there should be signs, warning, do not go down there. This could end you up in court. But there's a lot of work that can be done short of that. And we shouldn't forget that.
Yes, I that is so important. I'm sorry to keep jumping in, but it's so important that grassroots community-based work, that applies to everything. I won't go into detail. Everything we've been talking about can also be addressed by everyday ordinary people who care about each other working together. And in addition to, you know, the big politics of it all. So thanks for adding that, Wendy. So Allison, do you want to take the next question?
Do you guys fear that perhaps we're basically in the pre-Roe status quo where it's decided by the states? Do you fear that the court may go beyond that and try to say, like, state laws that allow abortion, these are unconstitutional as depriving, like, perhaps, like, life? Do you think that's a risk?
So I'm happy to jump in and start with that. So I was actually, as we were talking about the Parade of Horribles, I was thinking that we didn't actually mention how much worse it could get, sadly. So this, you know, for the first time, I'll bring up the very sad prospect of the personhood movement, which is, you know, we saw start in Dobbs through amicus briefs, but we're going to see continue, right? So, you know, the anti-abortion movement has been very, very clear that their goal is not to just overturn Roe, right? That's step one. The next is to ban abortion nationwide, right? They view this as murder. They want it gone. They're going to proceed, you know, along two lines to have that happen. The first, I think their hope was that they were going to do better than they did last night and potentially work towards passing a federal law that would ban abortion nationwide. So, you know, that they would have to, you know, obviously win both chambers of the legislature and the president to be able to do that. And, you know, just like the Democrats right now even when they had both chambers of the legislature and the president, were struggling because of the filibuster. Republicans would have that same problem. The anti-abortion movement has known that. And for a long time now, they've been starting on another thread, which is to make a constitutional argument that actually not only is there no substantive due process right to abortion, but actually the opposite is true. Fetuses are a persons from the moment of conception. They are given the right to life in the Constitution, and therefore, abortion has to be banned nationwide. There's flaws with this argument. Constitutional law people have, debated this with the state action requirement, et cetera. But certainly that is, where the anti-abortion movement is going. And, we're going to see this across state legislatures. So you might know that in a few states already, in Georgia, for instance, a fetus is considered a person under state law. I think it's at 6 weeks. I can't remember if it's from conception or at 6 weeks, but already that's altering how Georgia conceives of the rights of a fetus during pregnancy. So for instance, people who are experiencing pregnancy loss are now entitled to get tax credits. But obviously this has really serious implications for people who might self-manage an abortion because it opens up the possibility of murder charges, for instance. And so personhood is, to the extent that people care about the right to abortion, personhood is the real threat eventually that the Supreme Court could say, actually there's abortion should be banned nationwide. The question I think is whether or not Kavanaugh, who was very clear in his during oral argument and in his opinion that he viewed the Constitution as neutral, could go that far. But certainly if you were reading the opinions like I was with a mind toward personhood, that Justice Alito's opinion could certainly be read as, he really viewed himself to be doing this great civil rights opinion, referencing Brown versus Board and other cases as this potential that, I think he viewed that he was bestowing rights on a new class of people in a way that should be very concerning to people who care about abortion.
Yeah, yeah. And I would just add that fetal personhood was being protected back in the, starting in the late 1980s when Black women were prosecuted for being pregnant and using drugs based on the idea that the fetus is a person who needed protection from the state. And that was outside the context of abortion. Of course, they're merging now. Okay, next question. If the abortion issue is being sent back to the states and half the states continue to support abortion, would someone at least acknowledge that women's rights in those states remain protected? I think this is a call for us to make it clear that abortion hasn't been banned in every state and that there are states, including, I believe, I didn't follow all the referenda in the election yesterday, but I think they were good. The results were good for protecting the right to abortion. So,
Vermont, right? Michigan.
There we go. Thank you. Yes.
So Kentucky.
There we go. So we've acknowledged it. Thanks for asking us to do that. And then there's a question: what are the implications of these vast differences between the states?
Please jump in if also wants to. The implication for these vast differences, I think we're going to start seeing, unfortunately, many of the states that ban abortion already have some of the worst maternal health outcomes in the country. I think we're going to see those numbers, the polarization grow. Those of you who've been paying attention to this stuff know that in Texas, where abortion has essentially been illegal since September of last year, they have withheld the maternal mortality numbers because of the election yesterday. They didn't want the new maternal mortality numbers to be released. So I think, that's a pretty strong signal in light of other research that has come out showing that maternal morbidity was rising because physicians were delaying abortion care, that we're going to see pretty big public health differences in maternal outcomes between these two states. And then, obviously others on this call are better at this, but there's also huge differences in terms of, if you look at the Turnaway study, people who are denied abortion are also much more likely to struggle financially and have other long-term public health complications by being forced to have children that we'll see.
Can I add, I Yeah, I think we're going to see the increasing differentiation. We've already had it between states in terms of health outcomes. But, you know, it's also, I just think it's worth noting, right, how this is also playing into being caused by, but amplifying the deepening political polarization in the country, which is dangerous in and of itself, not only, and actually bad for health, but not only because of the specific things like maternal mortality, but because, you know, we're living in a political system that is on the edge, and maybe we didn't fall off the edge last night, but we're still near the edge. And the increasing animosity, and I'll just throw out, I mean, one of the things we've seen, and we see it, for example, in the EMTALA cases, the increasing recourse by states to run into court to challenge everything, right? It's now, what an attorney general of one party does is they think their major job is to stop the president of the other party. Like, when did this become a thing? It became a thing with the Affordable Care Act is when it became a thing. But we see this increasing sort of partisan division that's connected to geography and con law in ways that itself, I think, is very troubling to our democracy and our sense of the rule of law as constitutional litigation becomes increasingly performative and partisan.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Allison, do you want to take a question from the live audience?
I have a lot of people looking at me. None is raising.
I mean, I do have other questions.
I have one.
Have you guys talked about like the implications of the Comstock Act and a Republican administration enforcing that?
Patty, do you want to take that one?
No, I was going to say, I know Greer and her co-authors have thought about this. So,
okay, well, it's a great question, and Patty will correct me or jump in if I say anything wrong. For those of you who don't know, the Comstock Act, these were laws that were passed long, long ago before Roe to basically outlaw both abortion and contraception. Comstock was this person who was very kind of was historically charged with kind of starting kind of the legal movement to end contraception and abortion, I think in the early 1900s. Okay, so this law was passed. The law is still on the books, right? So there's a few flavors of them, but one of them says, probably the most important one says, it is illegal under federal law to ship any material, apparatus, or anything used for an abortion in the mail, okay? This law has not been enforced for a long time. There's a series of early circuit court cases that limit its interpretation. And then of course Roe happened. And it wasn't enforced for decades before Roe, but once Roe was there, it was presumed unconstitutional, right? The question now has become, now that Dobbs overturned Roe and this law is still on the books, is that going to essentially create a federal law that bans abortion? And this really relates to the preemption stuff, because obviously, you know, it's really hard for the federal government to say our FDA regulation of abortion trumps state law when there's an actual, not regulation, but law on the books that seems to say you can't actually ship anything in the mail that related to abortion. People in the abortion rights movement are aware of this law. They're nervous about this. It's going to certainly come up in the cases that do concern preemption. So there was an early case concerning preemption in Mississippi that has since been voluntarily dismissed by the plaintiffs. But once Dobbs came down and the plaintiffs tried to use preemption to challenge Mississippi's general abortion law, the defendants in that case came back with Comstock as a defense. We know that this is going to come up, and, you know, I think the argument, there's a lot of kind of ways to argue against the Comstock law, but it's one of them being that, of course, it would require abortion to be banned nationwide if it were in effect, because, you know, you can't ship anything. Even if you're in Connecticut, you can't ship anything in the mail that's used for an abortion. You know, all this is super novel, and how it relates to preemption is also really complicated.
Did you want to add anything, Patty? Or
no, I was just going to mention the Mississippi case that Mississippi raised the Comstock law. So it's a great, great question from the classroom.
Great. So I have two more questions, and I think I'll kind of combine them because we only have a couple minutes left. I think we have 3 minutes left and we have to end. So I think we addressed in a way about fetal personhood. And the question was about the burden on the pregnant person's body by a third party, and why should fetuses have preference to be able to put this burden on someone in a way that isn't allowed by already born people. And then the next was a statement that this is an ideological and worse, a theologically driven court. And what new arguments and approaches can work when you've got a court that's driven by ideology and theology? Won't the court just block them as antithetical to their theological principles? So those are the two comments/ questions, and maybe we can just end with some responses to those observations and questions.
I'll quickly say for the first part, I totally agree with this, right? And you remember from tort law, there's, you know, we have no duty to rescue in American law. And historically, you can even find cases where an uncle is not forced to donate blood to save the life of a niece or nephew. So many people have used this to kind of say, how is it possible that we're forcing pregnant people to endure pretty significant, extremely, I'm pregnant right now, so I can say, very significant burdens on your body to carry a child to term. How can we force that on someone to essentially, even if you accept that the fetus is alive, how can you do that, right? This is kind of a vein of the Judith Jarvis Thompson famous philosophy argument. And I think it's a great point, but it has not convinced courts recently or yet.
I will say, for the second question, I agree with the first question. And actually, that's one of the reasons why I'm a little nervous about this dismissal of equal protection, because one of the arguments is that you're discriminating against people, right, by putting on them a duty to care and protect in ways that damage their own potentially health that you don't do on non-pregnant persons. And so that quick dismissal of equal protection is problematic. I think Justices Gorsuch, Alito, and Thomas right now are lost causes in this area, right? I think that's very clear. I think showing up some of the dire implications of where the next steps would go and the inconsistencies and how other laws that they might like might fall. I mean, I think there's some potential hope with the other justices, but I think the three I just named are just very results driven and very theologically driven right now. And you can read it, in their opinions and in their concurring and dissents. So I don't think there's much point in making legal arguments to them, because these are not legal arguments that they're listening to.
Patty, do you want the last word before we have to end?
I will just say briefly, one response to the second question, I think, would be to return to Wendy's earlier comments that our vision needs to be larger than just litigation and the courts in terms of how to move the ball forward and protect people.
Thank you. So again, thank you so much for a great discussion so important, so urgent, and also not only pointing out the dire implications of Dobbs, but some of the strategies we can use to fight back and prevent the harms, the terrible harms that you all pointed out. So thanks so very, very much.
Thank you. you. So good to see you guys, by the way.
Yeah.
And nice to meet you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you so much.